Hi there. Thanks for checking in with us. Our latest conversation is about photography. We're three Black Pride grads. My name is Kenneth Nelson. I'm here with my very good friends, Mark Skinner and Greg Clayhorn. We're all graduates from Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, NYC. In this episode, we're going to be exploring what happens when a soundtrack is added to a photograph. What is it that the music or song will do when you add soundtrack to it? Some key questions to think about. Or does the soundtrack add or detract from an image? Is spoken word more effective than music? Or is literal music interpretation of an image hokier than a subjective interpretation? So to get started, I'm going to share my magical musical.
You are such an intellect, Ken. You come up with some stuff that makes me stop and really think about, but go ahead.
Okay. So I took an image of mine and I've married it up with a song, and just, here we got 30 seconds of it. Okay.
Interesting.
What do you think?
Tina Marie?
It's funny. So you're thinking about the act, the singer of the song.
Well, she brings up a whole genre of thoughts, you know. But one, interestingly enough, now I'm a media guy, film guy, you know, and I want to see, you know, the pictures change and change, but holding that one image really started making me focus on her character and how the song related to what she was about. She was different. You know, everybody else had their winter garb on, an umbrella on one side, the super expensive winter coat on the other side. Mm-hmm. But she had like this knit hat and she was about that grind. She had a whole different character and a different feel to her.
In that, like, the hustle and bustle of Wall Street.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. She had a totally different vibe that the song kind of accentuated. So that's what I got.
You picked a song that's definitely pre-internet. I mean, you know, it's pre-internet. It feels like a pre-internet song. It feels like one of those, you know, 1980s movies about, you know, making it in New York, you know. Yeah.
Like she's going to bust out and throw her hat up in the middle of the street like Mary Tyler Moore.
Well, that's the 70s, but I mean, and it's the Midwest, but I get you, Phil. Okay. But you're right. It's not even that she's just gotten to town, or maybe she's only had the job for 2 or 3 weeks. You know, that kind of thing. That's the sensibility that I get from that. That, you know, or she's had the job for a long time and she's going to, as Greg says, you know, break out of this rut, and she's going to go. So, that's what it feels like, you know?
Okay. So you've begun to create a story in your head.
Yeah.
And then as you begin to take a look at the story and you look at this image, who do you focus on for that story?
Oh, the person in the center, because they have a red hat and a red bag.
Okay.
The red, all of them have some red on. That's what I just noticed. You know, uh-huh. She's got red. The woman in front of her has red. The woman behind her has red. The person behind them has red. There's like this reoccurring, like, what was that, Sixth Sense with Bruce Willis? Mm-hmm. And M. Night Shyamalan. Good meds. Show that guy, M. Night. Every time he showed something red, there was something about to happen. There was a foreshadowing with the color. Mm-hmm. You guys remember that? Anyway, yeah.
No, I don't remember that.
Yeah, watch The Sixth Sense over. Every time he showed something red, something was about to happen, or something happened that foreshadowed something to come.
Really? I hate to say it, but what I remember most about that kind of storytelling is Schindler's List, when they had the little girl in the red coat who was falling, that kind of thing, where she was the only splash of color in that entire film.
But M. Night did every time he sewed something red, there was something important to the storyline. So, yeah, that's worth looking into. But I like the way you did that in this, Ken.
So it's what's the intersection of media and visuals? Is it cinematic? Is there a relationship to cinema in any way?
Well, I think cinema informs for us. I think the more movies you watch, the more you equate certain images and certain sounds with a certain time in history and a certain place.
Uh-huh. So would you say then this is the song is a literal interpretation of the image? Or is it something not necessarily literal, but more subjective?
I would say I think what you're doing is you're sort of feeding us bits of information that have that already have visual cues for us.
Right.
I mean, you know, we grew up in New York, so we know that's the hustle and bustle of the city, particularly Manhattan. You know, and
because we're everybody,
in the winter, and we're a certain age, so we know that that's probably Manhattan, you know, below 110th Street, most likely, you know, maybe even below 57th Street, you know, and we know that that's a regular New York style winter. It's not a huge snowstorm, but it's just the, you know, the gray day of a snowstorm, and people still have to get where they're going. And you can tell because the guy's wearing a Canadian Goose coat. That's a very new coat, right?
Yeah,
that's
expensive too. That's an Arctic jammy. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but it's really, you know, it's a really new coat. But that's kind of the eternal sensibility of the city, right? Or particularly Manhattan, that says no matter what, through rain and sleet and hail,
nothing's going to stop us. We're New Yorkers.
Right. Right.
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah, the intent for me was to be literal. So,
but my one observation I wanted to say with the mashup of the two things, photography is emotional on one level, or on a number of levels, but it's an emotional visual medium, you know, and just looking at it, you cannot, for me. You know, because I'm a New Yorker too, you cannot not have an emotional experience with this. Because I remember the cold. I did not care for it, but it's like, okay, all right, I got to get from here to here. I got to stay warm while I'm doing it. And that's an emotional thing. And then when you add the music to it, that's like a whole different set of emotions, you know.
Right.
'Cause like when you're walking through the city, you know, it's just a bombardment of emotions. You know, you're watching so you don't get hit by a taxi. You're watching to make sure the guy coming at you, talking on his cell phone and looking at the skyscraper, doesn't walk into you. You know, this all the thing, and the city has its own soundtrack. You know, the honking horns, the sound of 1,000. Footsteps, you know, doors opening, you know, it's random conversation. So there's this whole emotional hodgepodge of things going on, and then you add the music to it. It's like that brings back the first thing, because I was like the MTV generation there with Tina Marie and the bad dancing and the bad hair and, you know, all of that. I won't say bad, but. You know, certain you
retro, very like teased hair and things like that. Not bad, but just of it, but of its time.
Right, yeah. Exactly. So that had added a whole different contextual emotion to it. Memories of, you know, what was I doing at that time? And in wintertime, and maybe I had my headphones on, and it kind of adds to it, but in an unexpected way.
Yeah,
it is kind of cinematic, it is storytelling, but the fact that you chose to stick with one image while you did that kind of changed the conversation.
Well, also a lot of television and movies, films had the freeze frame at the end of a movie. So, you know, so the synergy between the music, the frozen frame, the New York City hustle and bustle before everyone had it. If you wanted to make a phone call, you had to go inside a building, you know, because you weren't going to make a phone call in this kind of weather from a phone booth that mattered. You know, you might call home just to leave a message for someone, but you weren't going to have a serious conversation on the street. Mm-hmm. And so that was, you know, it looks like it is of a time of place that photograph really isn't. Because for us, we're so familiar with it, you know.
Yeah, yeah, and it's interesting because the inclination for me when setting this up was to make sure that whatever I was using as a soundtrack matched the tempo of what I consider the image to be. Mm-hmm. So the tempo of the music, the tempo of the song was upbeat, and there was a da 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 happening to it. So it was supposed to sort of mimic the footsteps of people walking and walking by and stuff. So all those things come together to give an illusion of motion, or to enhance the illusion of motion within the frame. So I think that just adds to it.
Well, you know, it's funny. When you first brought up this topic for us, I was so set on trying to get one image together. Uh-huh. with one, I didn't think in terms, one image and song together, I didn't really think in terms of what would it be like to get the same image with a variety of soundtracks to see how that changes the context for us in one way or another. I mean, to me, when I see this photo without the sound, it looks like today. But that music is so specific to a certain time that it just pulls me right into that.
Yeah, cool.
And I do like the idea of Mark's comment about the end of the movie still, and there would be like this person that you follow through the whole story.
Uh-huh.
And then okay, here we go. And the soundtrack comes in, and it's like, okay,
right? As we are, I think I remember seeing that as a vehicle in Starsky and Hutch.
Right, and Greg was right. He's a Mary Tyler Moore, basically, did the same thing.
Going up the hair, going up the up. Right. Absolutely.
So, you know. That
looked like a birthday cake, like a layer cake hat. Which is kind of...
Yeah, I was waiting for the credits to roll. It would be like,
All right, so let's go on to Mark's. And we will...
Was that one part of a series, Ken? Sorry.
No.
Okay.
Well, it is part of a series, but not. It's part of a big series, part of my commotion series, but okay. It's not necessarily something I would show because it's not a select.
Okay.
All right?
Well, I think those closeness series that you do are so timely now that we're all COVID separate. But
we're all apart now.
Okay, Mark, this is yours. Okay. That's exactly.
Well, you know, it's funny. You guys say James Bond because I know why. Because it's the those high pitched strings and the orchestration reminds you of from Russia
dated
with Love.
Orchestration.
Well, right, it's dated, but it reminds you of the 007 theme from Russia with Love. Yep. But that's actually,
aren't they defunct?
Yeah. That's a turboprop from the 50s. That's at the TWA hotel.
JFK?
Yeah, JFK.
Oh, TWA. Okay.
And what's really nice about it, actually, you can't see the whole image here. It seems like it's been cropped in some way in my
Zoom
screen.
Oh,
there you go. So what I liked about this particular image is I got a sense of not only the jet age, but I got a sense of the jet age and the, even though it's a turboprop, and TWA and how, you know, future looked so bright, even though it's an overcast day, but there was this overwhelming sense of optimism. that
I love the JFK airport. It was beautiful. Those new modern lines that it had. I really
The Sirenin architecture is just absolutely fantastic. And it was closed for many years. It closed in 2001 in December.
That long.
And TWA went out of business then. And then they just opened it as a hotel about 2 years ago. It's beautiful on the inside, but I wanted to use this image because there was a sense of how air travel was. You know, air travel was a certain way. It was very wonderful to be able to get on a plane. You didn't have to, you know, get all of those didn't have to have everything checked. You didn't have to go through the x-ray machine for domestic traffic.
Remember those days?
The flight attendants were always friendly. If you were a kid, they would give you wings. You didn't have to ask. It was a luxurious experience if you could get on a plane before, 1997, 99. In the late 90s, it became a little bit sort of like they would throw you a sandwich on the plane, if you had lunch. But at one point, it was really good. And this reminded me that the music I picked was really about the jet age and all the optimism that had created this particular way of looking at air travel. And, after Kennedy was assassinated, some of that seemed a little bit frivolous. And people got a little bit more serious, and civil rights, started happening. And TWA stayed around for a while. They had a couple of problems, and they had a couple of financial problems. They had a hijacking. They had shootings. Just awful things had happened to them. But by the end of the 20th century, end of 2001, they kind of called it a day, and that was it. And it just seemed like an echo of a particular time that was much more hopeful than things seem today.
Mm-hmm. Jeez, Mark, I'm depressed now. Thank you.
No.
What the hell?
Bringing it back to a cinematic tone, there was... what's the name of the movie show? The movie, man. The song is so reminiscent of that movie. It's a Bondish movie, but I forgot the guy.
Oh, are you talking about Austin Powers?
Austin Powers. So that's where I'm going.
National Man of Mystery.
Anyone who probably seen that, again, I haven't seen Austin Powers, but I'm assuming there's a relationship between that song and this. But here's the thing about it. I begin to wonder, is the song indicative of the movie, or is the song indicative of the time? Not necessarily the case.
I think it's of the time. There were a lot of spy thrillers in the the early to mid 60s. Uh-huh. And certainly now the idea. I mean, there was what Derek Flint, who had a cigarette lighter that had 81 functions, 82 if you wanted to light a cigarette. that kind of thing. was fascinating. In those days. In all honesty, anyone who's got an iPhone now is not marveled by that, or any other smartphone. You're not marveled by that because you can read your blood pressure. You can take your own photograph. You can do anything that a super spy used to be able to do, with a everyday cell phone. And what's interesting is it was a time when I know that a lot of people really kind of were always, everyone was very aspirational. And I'm not saying it's, let's put it this way, I wouldn't return to that for anything. But in terms of style and design, I think there was a lot more care put into just creating architecture that was interesting, automobiles that were interesting, creating new ways of photographing. And I think now we've gotten to a point where there's much more efficiency is the empirical. We're more efficient with the way we create buildings. We're more efficient, and that's beautiful in its own way. But I think we should never kind of forget that as a as a group of people, there, you know, there was a time when there was such abundance that they could sort of, you know, indulge the imagination a little bit.
Okay, so as you began to think about the image and the audio track that you wanted to accompany this with, mm-hmm. were you thinking about yourself or were you thinking about an audience?
That's a good question. I was thinking primarily about myself because I remember the first time, probably the only time I went to the TWA terminals when my brother went on a trip to California when he was a kid and I was an even younger kid. And it just seemed like the most amazing place on the planet, you know, and I didn't realize how close it was to home. But when I was looking at this image, because I created this image for this particular talk, I just went out there and took some pictures. I thought about the all of the things that it meant. You know, there's the, you know, instead of a jetway, there's that little escalator, stairway on the left-hand side. You know, to get a view of the co-pilot side of a jet plane would have been mm-hmm. just the most amazing thing in the world, because we're never on the tarmac, you know. It's like, how do you get that kind of view?
Mm-hmm.
You know, the landing gear is pretty exotic to me. And so without being inside the plane, this is the closest I've ever been to the outside of a plane. You know, it's amazing. So I really thought about me first. And then when I created the pictures, I thought about a lot of, you know, how would I express this? And Soul Bossa Nova by Quincy Jones seemed right. That was the Austin Powers one. Uh-huh. But that seemed in a weird way a little too easy to just say, oh, it's 1960s. Okay. And I wanted something that felt more 1960s than said 1960s. So I just put it together. I mean, it's a very compressed image. It reminds me a little bit of the Roy Lichtenstein painting of the fighter jet. You know, it's mm-hmm. just a lot about a time.
You was know, the cropping intentional? Or
yes, very much so. Yeah, this was done in camera. Maybe I cut a little slither off just to sort of right. straighten out some lines, but this is done in camera. This is the crop.
Right. And so in that respect, it really the audio really accentuates it, because to some degree there's a sense that the plane is actually in the air.
Right, like it's banking to the left. Yeah,
due to the angle of that it is. And so, you know, there's a sort of a confusing part, because you know it's not in the air, but right. yet it has this sort of way of looking like it's in flight. So right. I think it's a cool idea, and I think the audio track really accentuates that thought. So that's right. a cool approach to that. But it's funny, because when we think about audio tracks to an image, you know, the question is, how do we think about it? Do we think about it internally, or we think about it externally? And if you think about it in both ways, I think that's a holistic look that allows you not to only understand it, but to share your understanding of that image with others and come to a sort of similar conclusion, although it may not be the exact same conclusion.
Well, I mean, I think I communicated that, you know, you're getting from it what I yeah. basically tried to do, particularly the banking of the flight, because we all have seen, at least we used to see, those commercials of banking jet planes yep. above the clouds.
Yep.
I think United used to do those, or American, one of the two. And it's very nostalgic, but it's not nostalgic. It's nostalgic for pretty much, I guess, my own childhood.
But I think this is, you said this is a turboprop, right?
Yeah, so okay. yeah, it's not a jet.
It's not a jet.
Right. It's a plane called the Constellation. They nicknamed it yeah. Connie.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Got it.
Yeah, DC-7.
Well, I don't. Oh gosh, I wish I knew. It might be a de Havilland. I should have looked it up. But I was just so anxious to get the photograph that mm-hmm. I please forgive me. I did not look up what kind of plane it was, and I had seen it when they first opened, but I don't remember. But it might be. I don't know.
No worries.
Cool. Yeah, well, you know, it's funny. I started thinking, well, yeah, I should look this up and see what kind of plane this is. And then I forgot completely to do that. So.
All right. Okay. Let's get to go and get to Greg's
Yeah, my apologies. I'm going through some oral surgery. I'm getting my implants in, so I'm painkillered up. So please forgive the drool, and at least I'm not snotting today. This is a good thing. All right, so this is my image.
Wear a mask.
It's an interesting. Yeah, of course. I got.
Yeah, let's listen to it first, Greg, and then come back and talk about it afterward.
All right, go ahead.
Okay.
What can I say? You know, I mean, election year, I know I'm going to date in this episode, but in an election year, and there's just a lot going on. And that I know he changed his name from Childish Gambino, but that song, This Is America, is just so powerful, you know, in my opinion. And this shot, I'm really curious to hear what you guys have to say about it. But these are some kids that do praise and worship in the church as mimes. They do this mime dance.
Yep.
And it's, oh, you're okay, you're familiar. But I just, there's just something about, you know, not blackface, whiteface, but theatrically covering your face. So it's almost like a kabuki, you know, the Japanese kabuki. And their features and their expressions and, you know, their full African lips and their wide noses and the look in their eye is just, it just, for me, it just kept drawing me in. And with, you know, seeing life through young eyes, you know, with all this madness going on, they're televising on TV. That's a terror for the television is almost the terror of the KKK, you know, showing all of these murders on TV, you know. And just the kids, I mean, the one on the left, the young lady on the left, she's like so innocent. Her head tilted to the side. There's a innocence to her, you know. And the older young lady at the center left top, you know, she looks like she's ready to roll. It's like she's seen it and she knows it's wrong. And just even without emoting anything, I feel it comes through. And the young lady to the right, she seems still has to see, have some compassion in her, but they're all looking right at you. You know, it's like, what else have you got to tell me? Are you going to tell me another lie? You know, I feel that it's really just you know, just the shapes of the faces, the expressions with the stark white faces, and the young man at the bottom, you know, he's like almost being protected by his older sisters, and I have something that I can identify with, having three older sisters. But he looks like he's still got just as clear vision as the rest of them, you know, but he's got some growing to do, you know, and it's this, you know, what am I seeing here, you know, and it's one thing I've really enjoyed about your series that you've done out with the protest marches for BLM and George Floyd is that now it's like after folks saw, you know, that officer basically murdered this black man on TV, all the races came out, you know, white folks came out, black folks, Latinos, Chinese, you know, you name it. They were like, no, this is wrong, you know, and this picture for me and that song, I feel they augment each other because it's like, okay, my eyes are open.
So what aspect of this particular photo is the this?
I don't understand your question. The this?
Right. I mean, this is America. Yeah. And I agree with everything you've said thus far. Mm-hmm. is a very
what aspect of the this strong, well, their right. eyes wide open. You know, it's like, okay. you know, I'm not, my eyes aren't closed. I may be whitewashed. I may, you know, have, you know, a white face on, but my eyes are open. I'm seeing everything that's happening now. And you can't tell me any different, because all their expressions say something specifically different. You know, there's a humanity in their expressions. You know, it's like, what's next? You know, I'm watching. Does that answer your question? That's the this.
It does. I am very much a fan of the visuals of the video. Very, very much a fan of the visuals and the entire story that it tells. And I think you've added a different perspective to that idea.
Especially because, you know, they're, you know, kids in church. And then I was always thinking about the Alabama church bombings. And then, you know, that... lunatic who went into a church, prayed with those folks, and then shot them. Mm-hmm. You know, and then for them later on to say, well, yeah, we forgive them. You know, that's something that, I mean, I've heard other people, other groups, you know, they've killed some of their, and these people are like, no, we don't forgive them. Right. These people said, no, we forgive them.
Now, how does that relate to any aspect of what you're saying with this photo?
Oh, yeah. I mean, just the expressions on their faces, like the young lady on the left, you know, the image, her expression is just so tender, you know, that there is almost a forgiveness and an apologetic, you know, expression to her, you know, whereas the one on the top center, no, she's not, I don't think she would be necessarily be very forgivable. She looks just so kabuki to me. It's like, you know, that a warrior face almost. And, you know, and they're young enough to be able to forget. They're not hardened, you know, to it's like, okay, whatever you say is a lie. I'm not believing any of it. And, you know, let's roll. But that's what I feel as far as the, as far as that aspect of it in the image, yes.
Okay, so as a viewer coming to this image and coming to the soundtrack, am I supposed to see the combination inwardly toward the image or outwardly from the image? So this is America. When I hear those words, I think those are the strongest things coming out of the audio track. So am I supposed to look in the image and see what's in the image as being America, or is it a sort of a, am I supposed to look outside of the image and they're looking outside and say that that's America out there?
I see. I think I see what you're saying.
Right. Because it depends on how you come to the image, because as I'm listening to the song, I could come to this and say, these images, these four people, that is America, right? Or you could come to it and say, these four people who live in this world, this is America. So it's not who they are, it's where they're at.
Right. Looking out, you know, visually looking out, right. And there's a POV, your point of view. Yeah.
Right.
Are you looking in to say these four people
yes.
are America?
Right.
Or are you supposed to be seeing
right.
what life or the world
yeah.
through their eyes,
yeah. through
what
their
they're eyes. Seeing out, you know, and how they're looking at me?
Yeah.
In a way, are you asking what my intent was?
I'm just making a I'm just bringing it up for conversation.
Okay. Well, in a way, it's I don't want to be duplicitous, but it's kind of both. You know, because it draws it what okay for me, I'll speak for myself. What drew me in was the starkness of their faces,
mm-hmm.
was the emotion, was the variety of their expressions.
Mm-hmm.
But then what I realized while I was doing it, like you were saying, it's like, what are they seeing?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what does the world look like through their eyes? Mm-hmm. You know, which shows, you know, because sometimes I'll be in a space, excuse me, and a friend of mine will be, Craig, fix your face. I'm like, what are you talking about? I had like snarled up, you know, looking at somebody, you know, kind of half crazy, unconsciously, you know. So what you see affects you and affects what you portray. So there is a duplicitous, that's mm-hmm. not the right word. There is a duality of impression and expression.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think the inherent ambivalence between the faces. I think we bring a lot to this. I mean, we're so accustomed to seeing, you know, blackface with a really hugely bad feelings associated with blackface on anybody, that to see the white face on black people. Presuming they're black, or maybe they're
are. Yes, they are. They're all okay. Black. All
right. So, black people with white face, you know, we bring to that a lot of emotional baggage to begin with, and I think that Ken's question is a good one, but I'm not sure if, as a viewer, I necessarily read all the things that you're talking about. It's they're literally blank slates, and you know, we can sort of apply what we wish for each face, depending on whatever our visual biases are. We can say one has a blank face, one has a happy face, one has a sad face, one has a mean face, or an angry face, I should say. And it depends on how we interpret the nuances of facial structure. Mm-hmm. I this is a tough one because I'm just not sure that I would see this and get a sense of this is America. I do think I would get a sense of theatrical, something theatrical going on. And I'd be very interested in finding out what's going on. But I don't think I'd necessarily think this is America, particularly since that particular video is so strong in its visuals. It's a tough thing to do, to try to extract that soundtrack and place it on something that's so still.
I would recommend getting into like a progressive church where they do this type of what do you call it, their praise and worship, to see what they do and how they do what they do. Mm-hmm. It's interesting to see. Ken, I think Ken knows what I'm talking about because he said he's seen some of these folks do this performance. Is that this? That's not performance.
I've been to recitals where there's a similarity to some type of, sometimes there's a church recital, and where they're doing a play of some sort.
Okay.
And so I've never seen it in a facial thing or mask. It would just be face.
Because they usually do their worship to a gospel song, and they'll do, I've seen them do like a little story, like the crucifixion story. They'll do something like that. And it's part mime, part ballet, part modern dance, part theatrical, yes, most definitely. But I mean, as far as this image goes and that song,
yeah,
for me, I mean, because the eyes, this, okay, even without the soundtrack, for me, this image is very difficult to look at and in a large print. I printed like a 30-40, which was the largest I could do at the time. But if this print was larger, it's very uncomfortable for me to look at this image because they're unblinking, looking right into you, you know? And that's what I
I think you've given it no other option but to do that.
Right. Exactly. Right?
You've given no external context to what the surroundings are. And right. So therefore you've asked us and you've forced us to look at these eyes and look at these faces, nothing else. Right. So there's no ambiguity, right, as to what we're supposed to look at. And then you married it with that image. And that sort of, for me, it reinforces that thought. But of course, I'm going to bring my own observations and thoughts and history to it. So therefore, whatever I did yesterday, matter of fact, the way I view this and listen to the song. Now, as Mark said, the video is a very strong video, but I would have come out of it with the fact that I wouldn't have included the visual of the video. I would have taken this image on its own merits and married that up with the audio that you brought it with. And I took it into this context and not the actual original video at all.
You're good. You're good. It was very difficult for me to do that.
Right, because I haven't seen, remember, I forgot that you actually sent us a link to the video a year ago, Mark. So it's no longer in my radar anymore. And so yesterday when I saw it for the first time again, I was like, oh, that's that video, right? But I still, when I look at this image, I look at that image and I can see that outside the video itself. Because I think the audio image is so strong. Yeah, I could see this, yeah. Okay. It doesn't harken back to the video, as with Mark it does.
No. Well, the song does, but not the visual. Yeah.
Right. Right. That's what I'm saying. For me, the song does not harken back to the video as strongly as it does for Mark.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, it's also, an image of four young African-American children, is that kind of a overdoing it? Four African-American children. And this is their America, for me. This is kind of what I'm seeing. That's why I thought of that song for this image.
It's a statement you want to make.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. A silent statement, but a screaming silent statement. I mean, you can't. But like you're saying, the viewer brings their experience to this. My experience as a mime, knowledge of mime, the art of mime, to express, all this heartache and all this, seeing people killed in the street over and over and over, but you're still calling to God, it's things that I bring to it visually that speak to me and what for me brought those two images together.
Right. Well, see, that's what I'm saying. Like without prior knowledge of that video, if I just heard "This is America, this is America, this is America," I don't necessarily overlay a lot that imagery.
This is America.
Right, but I wouldn't necessarily.
A lot more.
That's true, but I wouldn't necessarily overlay the type of imagery. No, I wouldn't overlay the images of despair necessarily with these kids. I really
said anything about despair.
Well, I'm saying despair because a lot of the. Horrible things that are going on now would cause one to despair.
Because in essence, what would happen is if we were to see this and hear that audio track back in December, it would relate differently.
If it's not despair, what emotion would we get from a completely visual, clean overlay of that soundtrack to this image? Would we get a joyous one, or
not necessarily would we get joyous? This is a face of perseverance. I mean, in the video, I'm going to ask you to can you cue that song up again so we can hear the other things he says.
But then you're saying persevering against what, though? I mean,
all of this that's going on, all of this nonsense,
But that'd be what? In opposition to despair.
Yes.
It's America. Don't get
Don't catch me slipping. I mean, it's like, keep your eyes open. The game is, it's on. Don't catch me slipping. No, this isn't time for slipping or despair or holding your head down. Keep going. That bass line just is like the most incredible bass line. It's just kind of like that Tina Marie, that beat, like this beat of the city. It's like, okay, keep moving, keep moving, keep moving. You know, the game is on, or the war is on, or whatever, it's on. I don't feel that there's despair. You know, these things, these are terrible tragedies. These are horrific, terroristic tragedies. And they're like,
but doesn't tragedy cause one to despair, and then there's uplifting, you know, actions and uplifting thoughts.
Because Greg, to a great degree, what could happen is, in this particular circumstance, you've married an audio track with a song that is very progressive in its statement about what's going on in America today.
It's action packed.
If you were to take a gospel song, and marry it with this image, the context would be totally different. But if you were to, right, a gospel song accompanying this would have a different mindset.
Right.
Right.
And
so
I don't feel that they would marry up. But go ahead.
Well, Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. Right.
What a lovely singing voice song, have, Mr. Newman.
And just it with this image, and it would have evoke a different feeling, a different thought. So therefore, this is the essence of what we're getting about today, about this thing, is like, how does an audio track affect the way you see a visual? Okay, and we know that it does, because it affects it in motion pictures, but how effectively does it affect in a still image? And that's just the context of that's what we're talking about today. So it definitely can have an impact. It can change the way you think about an image, because you're marrying up audio and visual together.
Okay.
Right?
Agreed.
No. So you then become to say, okay, what is the intent of the artist when they give this to you? Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay.
So as the artist, you have to say, what is my intent, and what am I trying to evoke in my audience? And am I successful, or how successful do I want to be in conveying it, or do I care or not? Right? Mm-hmm. If you don't care, then okay, it's what they get. But if you do care, then you have to be very methodical in getting feedback on, are you getting your point across the way you want to get your point across? Mm-hmm. Right? Now, we don't do that with a still image by itself. We sort of depend on ourselves to do that. But once you start to marrying up a different thing to your image, then it becomes something else.
Right. We were talking about street photography a couple of weeks ago, and the idea of the decisive moment and having a number of actions in a photograph. And that's what makes some of the greatest street photographs great, is that there are a number of things occurring at the same time. And you get a sense of these different actions that give you a huge story. We were talking about that with the story episode. And so with this particular photo, you know, I asked what this was in the This Is America, because there's a lot of activity going on in that song. And
he also says a whole lot more than This Is America.
He does say a lot more, but with this particular photo, what's wonderful about it, and I really do like the photo, is that it is a wonderful template for a lot of things. You can explain a lot of what goes on in a song while listening to it to yourself, but I don't think it necessarily conveys everything, all of the activity and the reading of the minds of the kids. Like I was saying before, you know, it depends on how we as individuals read expressions. I mean, I remember a long time ago, there was someone I knew who I used to feel that they were always frowning, and someone reminded me, no, that's just their face, you know.
Okay, and so they weren't. What do you see in their faces?
Oh, like I said, because of the paint, I really see the, I see something, I see kids who are posing for a theatrical portrait, because I do know that faces don't tend to get, you know, geographically, geometrically, and very sharply delineated like that, even when there's different colors in on one skin. So I do get a sense that there's a something theatrical going on. But I don't necessarily get the idea that one's met. I see people who are very, I see them being very serious. I see them as serious people who are very serious about their performance. They're making sure to help the photographer get just the right image. They're posing properly. I get a sense of confidence from each child. And mostly confidence and a sense of well-being that you were talking about with the gospel work, not the gospel work, but you said it's part of a church. I get a sense that they are very much self-aware and well-adjusted kids.
So, and I'll jump in because I'll straddle both sides of the fence. Because as you were giving me your assessment of the image, Greg, I was following through with you and I was 100% behind you. But just as Mark just intimated himself, as he was explaining what he was seeing, I was following right behind him too, because I could see his point of view equally within these faces. And I was looking at it because I was seeing the ways the faces were and how you were seeing them. And therefore, I began to see them as such. But as Mark was explaining to me just now, or saying to us, what he saw, and I was like, yeah. But as he was saying that, there were some things that were valid for me as to why he was saying it. And it's because the mouths are very similar in their expressions. And that, to me, was the clue that they're all at the same level of emotion. So there's no variances within the emotion. So therefore, to me, that's why the possibility of this image being posed becomes more absolute.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe. I mean, I understand what you're saying at one level, but I don't know. I've been going past the mask, you know, because I've done theater, uh-huh. And yeah, you can pose, but you can pose in character.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, and the what the intent is of the person behind the mask is just as important as the superficial posing. You know, anybody can pose, but if you can, you know, I mean, sometimes the face doesn't match the character, if that makes any sense. But I mean, I see their mouths. I mean, you can't. It's hard to divorce their mouths from the rest of their face.
Well, we know that given certain circumstances, there are certain facial characteristics that happen during emotional times. We associate a smile with happiness, a frown with sadness, a smirk.
Or unless you're criminally insane, like the Joker, right. He smiles right. All the time, and he ain't happy.
Right. Well, but I think there's a cultural bias that we have towards black features when we are serious, that we are depicted as, if we're serious, we're mean. And I think that, I think these kids are just serious and I think they're self-confident. And I don't think that any of the faces look mean to me. I just think they're kids who really, they take what they're doing seriously.
Right. And, what Greg said, they're giving you their expressions in character.
Right. See, now that I don't necessarily get that, because for me, character, and I'm not a good judge, because it's I would, you know, I always need some sort of exaggeration to get the idea once someone's in makeup or something like that, because, you know, the subtleties
a favorite actor? Like the Bond thing, since we mentioned Bond, we brought up Bond. You'd expect Roger Moore to be suave and debonair, and he would portray that, as opposed to Mike Myers, when he plays Austin Powers, when he tries to play, you know, suave and debonair, but then he smiles and he's got, you know, the alligator teeth. It doesn't, you know, it, that is the character for that character.
Right. Well, so the character is the that character Moore, is completely unaware. Right.
You know,
right. So he's completely unaware of how unattractive that character is what Michael Moore's, Michael Myers, Austin Powers is, you know, that character, thinks he's better looking than he is, thinks he's more suave than he is. He's, you know, his conceit gets the best of him. So I get your comparison, but I don't know the character.
You don't have an emotional connection to this. Do you have any emotional connection to this image?
No, and I think that's what I'm trying to express is I just come to this as a clean slate, and I just see young portrait. People with, I see young people with masks. I see them put together. It may be a portrait. It may be an artistic expression that was created just for the photograph, but I don't see the exaggerated features that I would see with anger or sad or innocence or, you know, a lot of the things that you talked about in the beginning. I would say, I just see, you know, they're making sure to tilt their heads just right as per probably the photographer, to get the right composition. But I don't see the emotional.
Are you familiar with the kabuki masks?
Yes. Yes, I am.
Do you see the emotion in those masks?
Sometimes.
Wow. They are extremely exaggerated. Every single one, because their intent is to evoke a certain emotion. And you only sometimes see it through.
Well, I mean, here's the thing. You can compare kabuki. But this is, I mean, is this, I mean, are there characters as expressive as the kabuki masks are?
Well, for me, I mean, when I look in their eyes, each one has different expression in their eyes. Not only that, but then to have an African-American children in whiteface and all you can see is their, you know, stark features, their eyes, their wide nose, their thick lips. You know, their braided hair. You know, that says a lot to me. You know, emotionally, this picture is like, it says a lot, because it's like they're kind of looking out, and it's like, what? You know, what's going on? They're like almost looking to me for answers. Like, okay, what have you given me? What have you left me here? That is the emotional draw for me when I see their eyes, these young eyes. What, and then like Ken was saying, like what they're seeing from their point of view, and then what I'm seeing from my point of view, it's like this back and forth thing that I that's very emotional to me. But if you don't see it, I can't do anything about that.
You can't fault anybody for doing that, because everybody's going to come again. Everyone's going to come
at it. 100 people see it. 100 people will see different things. So,
different things. So we've gotten a little bit off the track in terms of what the genesis
soundtrack
of.
Track to the.
Yeah, you're right. And we're coming up on a good time to just break away and sort of sign off for this episode. So I just want to get some thoughts and as we close out for this.
Well, I'm just jumping. My thoughts, once you add another medium to a photograph, it just changes the context. It changes everything about the image. Like you said, you play a gospel tune to this, it becomes a different image. You play the song, you know, This is America, different context. You know, they say, oh, a picture paints 1,000 words. Yeah, but which words?
Mm-hmm.
You know,
right.
Da Vinci Code thing. That and pictures don't lie. Yeah, they lie. Lie a rub all the time. So I like the exercise. Thank you, Kitty Bravo, for coming up with this one. because music is such a powerful emotional medium. And I believe photography is just as powerful when done, you know, done.
Let me ask this. Is there any intent that you see, both of you, in the future to marry any image of yours with an audio track?
I don't have any plans right now. I used to do some slide presentations when I for pageants and some things like that, but nothing in the immediate future. I will say this. I got to say, you know, this was a nice assignment. I appreciate it. We should kind of do this periodically to see, you know, where we are, you know, how we're thinking about things and what we're thinking about.
Yeah.
Yes, ooh. I most definitely am working on a presentation with I'm still trying to put together my cross country thing, and you gentlemen are going to help me organize my photograph. Thank you very much. And my master's is in film production and film. So I enjoy, you know, when an image is married to sound, it just goes somewhere totally else. And I really enjoy that part of it. Mm-hmm. So yes, I am most definitely, you know, marrying the two, because one, they speak different languages, but when they start talking to each other, it's beautiful.
Okay, cool. So with that, we'll close out this episode. And as usual, if anyone out there looking at this and is still with us as of now has questions, concerns, or just like to maybe think about an image that they have that they'd like to marry to or combine with an audio track, let us know what that would look like or what that would sound like. And we'll give you our feedback. All right? Okay. Until then, guys. Thanks for joining. Catch you later.
All right. Bye-bye. All right.